A warm welcome to all of you to a revision class on customs duties. So what do you mean by custom duty? As per standard English dictionary, customs means duties imposed on imported or less commonly exported goods. It was an ancient custom that whenever a merchant entered a kingdom with his merchandise, he had to make a suitable offering of gifts to the king. This was the practice at that time. In the course of time, the modern state formalized this custom into customs duty, which the state collects on goods imported into or occasionally exported out of its frontiers. So what do you mean by customs duty then? Customs duty refers to the indirect tax. There are two types of taxes. One is direct tax and the other one is indirect tax. GST is an indirect tax and customs duty is an indirect tax, because the impact of tax can be shifted to somebody else. For example, ultimate consumer. Finally, it is the consumer who is going to bear the taxes. Indirect tax levied on the import or export of goods in international trade. So customs duty, it is applicable to international trade. There are two important division here. One is import duty and the other one is export duty. Duty levied on goods imported is called import duty, and duty levied on exports is called an export duty. Normally, all the goods imported from some other countries will be levied with import duty. But as far as export duty is concerned, that is encouraged. Normally, export duty is not levied for on most of the goods. Hardly only a few goods export duty is being levied. And especially whenever there is short supply of goods within the country, export of goods might be discouraged by levying export duty. Item number 83 of the union list. There are three lists, you know, union list, state list and concurrent list. Item number 83 of the union list of the Constitution of India delegates the power to the central government to levy duties of customs. Thus, the tax collections exclusively belongs to the central government. Customs law is covered under various acts, rules, regulations and notifications as follows. Major act is Customs Act 1962, popularly known as CA Act 1962. This is the main act which provides for levy and collection of duty, import as well as export procedures, prohibitions on importation and exportation of goods, penalties, offenses, etc. All these are covered in Customs Act 1962. Because that is a main act which governs the customs duty. Then another important act which regulates or which is applicable to customs duty is Customs Tariff Act 1975, popularly known as CTA 1975. This act contains two schedules. Schedule number one, which gives classification and rates of duty for imports. Well, Schedule 2 gives classification and rates of duty for exports. The first schedule gives two rates of goods for goods imported, duty for goods imported. First is the standard rate and the other one is the preferential rate. Preferential rate is normally lower than the standard rate. Goods imported from notified preferential countries are levied preferential rates. So you might be having a contract or agreement with some countries, and in that case, if goods are imported, tax levied by a country might be little lesser than the standard rate. In addition, CTA makes provisions for all provisions for duties like additional duty, preferential duty, anti-dumping duty, safeguard duty, and protective duties, etc. All these will be explained in subsequent slides. Apart from the above, customs law includes certain rules, regulations, notifications under Customs Act. I'm not going to deal with that because already that has been covered. This is just a recollection of what you have studied earlier. Okay, which is the regulating authority of customs duty? See, for direct tax, regulator is CBDT, Central Board of Direct Taxes. Whereas for indirect taxes, earlier it was CBEC, Central Board of Excise and Customs. But after the enactment of GST, CBEC is replaced by CBIC. What it means is Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs. It is a regulating authority for proper implementation of customs law. Now let us look into some of the different types of customs duties. In India, customs duties are levied on the goods and at the rate specified in the schedule to the Customs Tariff Act 1975. The taxable event is import into or export from India. So taxable event is event. If occurs, the tax will be levied, like import of goods or export of goods. Now let us see the important types of duties that are levied, especially on imports. First one, basic customs duty. This is the basic duty. Normally 10% duty will be levied on assessable value. So this is the duty levied under section 12 of the Customs Act. Normally it is levied as a percentage of value as determined under section 14(1), that is assessable value or transaction value. The rates vary for different items. The rate of duty may be at the standard rate, or in the case of import from notified countries, at the preferential rate. Normally 10% is levied on the transaction value or assessable value if nothing is stated in the problem. Okay, next one is integrated tax under section 3 subsection 7 of the CTA 1975. This is popularly now known as IGST. With the introduction of GST from 1st July 2017, that's called IGST, Integrated Goods and Services Tax. It is component under GST law, which is levied on goods being imported into India from other country. It has been subsumed various customs duties, including countervailing duty, special additional duty of customs. Earlier, these duties were levied separately along with basic customs duty. But now, after the introduction of GST, all these duties like countervailing duty, special additional duty of customs, these are not applicable. They are subsumed into IGST. Many of imports would attract a levy of IGST, except a few commodities such as pan masala, certain petroleum products, which attract a levy of CVD, countervailing duty. Even now that is applicable. Further, a few products such as aerated waters, tobacco products, motor vehicles, etc. would also attract levy of GST compensation cess under above IGST. Okay, now let us see social welfare surcharge duty. So popularly known as SWS. The general budget abolished the education cess and secondary and higher education cess on imported goods, and in its place imposed a social welfare cess at 10% of the aggregate duties. Union budget 1819 abolished the education cess. Earlier, for your information, education cess and secondary and higher education cess was levied on all goods imported on the basic customs duty. But that is being replaced by social welfare cess at 10% of the aggregate duties of customs. Certain specified goods, namely gold, silver, and motor, shall attract the surcharge at 3%. However, the following duties shall be excluded for computing SWS, that is social welfare surcharge. However, the following duties shall be excluded for computing SWS, like safeguard duty, countervailing duty under section 9, anti-dumping duty, SWS itself on imported goods. Also, the goods which were hitherto exempt from education cess and secondary and higher education cess shall remain exempt from SWS also. In other words, SWS is levied only on basic customs duty. In cases where imported goods are labeled anti-dumping duty or safeguard duty, calculation of anti-dumping duty or safeguard duty would be as per the respective notification issued for levy of such a duty. Value for calculation of IGST shall also include anti-dumping duty amount and safeguard duty amount. If any subsidy is given by the foreign government or any other agency to the exporter, it must be added and considered for levy of IGST too. Now let's move on to one more duty, goods and services tax compensation cess, under section 3 subsection 9 of the CTA 1975. When GST was introduced, many state governments, finance ministers of many state governments, resisted the introduction of GST, fearing the loss of revenue. So in order to help the state governments from incurring losses because of introduction of GST, compensation cess was levied by the central government on certain goods, and that will be made use of to give compensation to state governments for loss of revenue. Now there are two sections here. One is section 3 subsection 9, other one is section 10. Let us look into section 3 subsection 9. Compensation cess is levied on section 8 of the GST, Compensation Cess to State Act 2017. GST compensation cess is levied on both intrastate means within the state, and interstate supplier goods, services to provide compensation to the states for loss of revenue due to implementation of GST. GST compensation cess is applicable only to such supplier goods or services that have been notified by the central government. This is as per section 3 subsection 9, a tax levied called GST compensation cess. Now one more thing, this is on import of goods. Under section 3 subsection 9, that is on goods supplied within the state or between the states. But this is on import of goods. So GST compensation cess, GST compensation cess under section 3 subsection 10 of CTA 1975. Any notified article which is imported into India shall, in addition to BCD, basic customs duty, and integrated tax, be liable to the GST compensation cess at the rate as is levyable under section 8 of the GST compensation cess Act 2017. On like articles on its supply to India, on the value of the imported article as determined under section 10 of CTA 1975. CTA means Customs Tariff Act 1975. So this is applicable in the case of import of goods. Okay, next one is protected goods duty, protecting the industry from what? Let us see. They are intended to give protection to indigenous industry, that is domestic industry, and not for the purpose of raising revenue. The intention is not to raise the revenue, but to give protection to domestic industry. Basic idea is that growth and development of industry should not be hampered or hindered by unrestricted imports. the determination of the issues regarding the goods to be covered by such protective measure is left to an expert body called the Tariff Commission. Okay, similar to protective duties, there is one more duty, that is safeguard duty. So protective duty, yes, that will be decided by the Tariff Commission. Okay, now look into safeguard duty. Section 8B of the CTA, that is Customs Tariff Act, was introduced in 1997, which imposed the central government to impose safeguard duty on only notified imported goods, not on all goods, if it is satisfied that the goods are being imported in large quantities and under such conditions that they are causing or threatening to cause serious injury to domestic industry. So on safeguard duties on notified imported goods, if it is satisfied that the goods are being imported in large quantities and under such conditions that they are causing or threatening to cause serious injury to domestic industry, government has to conduct an inquiry and then issue a notification. The duty once imposed is valid for 4 years unless revoked earlier, unless cancelled earlier. This can be extended by government, but total period of safeguard duty cannot be more than 10 years. The duty is in addition to any other customs duty being imposed. Next one is countervailing duty on subsidized goods or bounty fed articles. A foreign government may give some subsidy to certain industries in order to export the goods. So in that case, the manufacturers of our country, they will be in a disadvantageous position. So to give a level playing field, countervailing duty is levied on subsidized goods or bounty fed articles. Let us look into the details. If a country, foreign government or any public trust pays any subsidy directly or indirectly to its exporters for exporting goods to India, central government can impose countervailing duty up to the amount of such subsidy under Section 9 of the Customs Tariff Act. This duty shall be in addition to any other duty. Countervailing duty ceases to have effect on the expiry of 5 years unless revoked earlier. Countervail means to have the same value, to compensate for, or to neutralize. So when countervailing duty is levied, the advantage enjoyed by the foreign exporters will be nullified, neutralized, and you are going to compensate the manufacturers in India so that they can compete with the foreign exporters who enjoy subsidy. Anti-dumping duty. This is nothing but cheap goods are dumped into the domestic market and the goods are sold at a price either equal to or less than the cost, so that that will cripple the domestic industry or that will drive away the domestic competitors from the competitive world. So to avoid such things and to protect our domestic industry, anti-dumping duty is being levied. Let us look into the details. Many times, here there is a repetition of the word, large manufacturers from abroad may export goods at very low prices with the intention to cripple domestic industry or dispose of their excess stock. This is called dumping. In order to avoid such dumping, the government can impose under Section 9A of CTA anti-dumping duty up to the margin of dumping on such articles if the goods are being sold at less than the normal value. The duty is given as a percentage is calculated on assessable value. National Calamity Contingency Duty. National calamity or natural calamities may occur like flood, earthquake, cyclone, etc. that may cause a lot of loss to the people and also to the properties of the country, and therefore to give some compensation, etc., and to come out of the trouble, and to finance and to go for rescue and rescue operation. Okay, national calamity contingent duty may be levied and the amount may be utilized for rescue operations and also to reconstruct the destroyed industry or whatever it is. This duty is imposed on pan masala, chewing tobacco, cigarettes, tobacco products, crude oil, mobile phones, two-wheelers and motor cars. With the introduction of GST, national calamity contingent duty has been abolished on all goods except on tobacco products. Now, what is export duty? It is a customs duty levied on export of goods from India. The second schedule of Export Tariff Act contains only 26 items. Of that, 25 items are exempt by way of notification. This is because our focus is on export promotion and import substitution, discourage import and encourage export, and therefore in most of the cases export duty is not levied, except in one case. At present, 15% export duty is levied on hides, skins and leather. From 137 2007, export duty has been imposed on iron ores at rupees 300 per ton and on chromium ores at rupees 2000 per ton. Yes, in this connection, let us see the date for determining the rate of duty and tariff valuation of imported goods. See how to calculate the assessable value or tariff value in order to levy the import duty, or we call that basic customs duty. So for that, you have to convert the goods purchased in foreign currency into Indian currency. Now, what is the rate of duty? And how it is to be calculated, let us see. The rate of duty on goods, a date for determination of rate of duty and tariff valuation of imported goods. The rate of duty on goods entered for home consumption. There are two types of goods. One is goods meant for home consumption, and other one is goods which are kept in godown, warehouse. So two forms of clearance. One is clearing for home consumption, and the other one is clearance for clearance from a warehouse. So home consumption means after the goods enter the customs frontiers of India, they will reach the consumers for home consumption. Okay, other one is they will be kept in the warehouse and later on that will be cleared for home consumption. Okay, now what is the date for determination of rate of duty? Because rate of duty may vary from time to time, but what is the time we have to consider, or what is the date we have to consider in order to determine the rate of duty, rate of customs duty? The rate of duty on goods entered for home consumption shall be the rate as on import by aircraft and vehicle, the date of filing bill of entry. This is an important document, filing of bill of entry, or the date of arrival of aircraft or vehicle, whichever is later. So there are two clauses here, date of filing the bill of entry. The other one is date of arrival of aircraft or vehicle, whichever is later. Next one, import by vessel. In that case, the date of filing of bill of entry, or the date of entry inwards. In the case of vessel, it is date of entry inwards. The first one remains the same, inwards to the vessel, whichever is later. The above provisions do not apply to baggage and goods imported by post. In case the goods cleared from a warehouse, I told you as soon as the goods reach India, they will not be cleared for home consumption. The importer will keep the goods in warehouse. Of course, for that he has to pay some charges. On the date on which ex-bond bill of entry for home consumption is presented, so the date on the rate of duty on this date, that will be considered. That is, on the date on which ex-bond bill of entry for home consumption is presented. in the case of any other goods on the date of payment of duty. Thank you.